Hello, hello, hello. Makadienu, Cholen Jani, how are you doing? This is Tete Rasta. I wanted to come to you today and just do an installment on an issue that's been quite close to my heart, particularly lately. And I think it's going to help some people. I wanted to talk about grief. I wanted to talk about bereavement. I want to talk about the grief cycle and how this can help, those people who can identify with what I'm talking about to move on. I think we'd be hard-pressed to find anybody who has never experienced grief at some point in their life. And when I talk about grief in this particular talk, I'm touching mainly on the loss of life, so the bereavement. I'm also going to be talking about, losses in life, because losses in life can also bring about a sense of grieving that is as difficult to deal with as when you have lost somebody in your life. So this one is going to really just focus on the way if you're not affected yourself. You may have somebody close by or within your circles who may be going through that process. It can also prepare you as to what can you do in order to be a good friend, a good neighbor, a good friend. So I just want to encourage you to share this if you think it's going to help somebody, because that is the intention today. So let me just start by talking to you about why I've kind of come around to wanting to talk about this. I always kind of keep an eye on things that are happening on my friends' pages. And then one of the things that really touched me, that kind of prompted me to start thinking about grief and how you deal with grief, is a friend of mine called Mark. And he and his wife lost a beautiful little girl. And my gogo as well, in Scotland, she lost her daughter, grown-up young lady, my name is Pamela. And, there are others that I can't name. In Inuo Zhangu, I put my cover pictures of my parents. I lost them. It took me ages to kind of get through that grief cycle. And the reason why I want to talk about this three is that from my own experience, nothing in life could have ever prepared me for what happened to my family in 2002. So let's just start by our definitions, because I can see you guys are coming in. So when we're looking at grief, we are really focusing on intense sorrow. So this is not just mild or moderate sorrow, it's intense. Something that is intense means that it's got the ability to shake you up, to disorientate you even, or to get you off track of the things that you would normally be able to do. So is met with grief. It's a very traumatic time for them. It's a very difficult time for them. And there's no prescription to say grief starts here and it ends there. So never be the person who says, get over yourself, get in stream. So it's intense sorrow, especially caused by a death or a loss. So there's misery, there's sadness, there's anguish, there's pain and distress. And some people are not very good at showing emotions or showing distress. They put on a very brave face. But the event of having had that kind of loss should signal to you, if you are their friend or you are their associate, that this person is going through a really difficult time and they need your sensitivity and your empathy and even your sympathy. Okay, so I wanted to just build on this issue on grief and loss, because it's all around us. And sometimes we can easily call it out, but other times we are not able to call it out. But you have to be discerning. Discerning means that using your faculties that are more intelligent in order to come to an understanding that is wise. So, often when people are bereaved, their lives will change because the life cycle is affected. And I've got my other friend there, Marv. I always see your post when the anniversary of your brother come up. And this is part of the reason that I'm doing this show, because we all lose loved ones. The surest thing in life is death and taxes. So it's something that we have to be thinking about so that we can start preparing and planning. And someone like me was never really exposed to loss, life losses when we were growing up. We're very sheltered. Even when my granddad passed away and my grandmother passed away, we didn't go to the funeral. So I didn't know the impact of a loss of somebody who was very close to you until it was that time of my parents. And I was ill prepared. And it's only when I then went into nursing school and, you know, and I started understanding some of the psychological theories that underpin this, which I shall touch on today, because I think it's going to help somebody. So sorrow of our soul, when our soul departs from our physical body, is the thing that leaves us with just a shell. And then we are left to bury the remains of that individual. And, you know, when we start looking at this cycle of grief, I shall put a little diagram in this feed so that you all can see what I'm talking about. The first thing that usually comes in is shock and denial. So many people, they get into a mode of avoidance. In Inua, I've had a series of losses, especially in the last 18 months. If I hear about loss right now, I am not equipped to deal with it because I'm already dealing with other things that that have come since then. So, you know, when people are in an avoidant state, don't be judgmental. It's very, very important not to be judgmental, because for a lot of us, it's about the proximity to the person who's gone. So if you are closer to the person who's bereaved, you are going to be more affected. And if you are not as close, you may be less affected. But it doesn't mean that the loss is not the same. Confusion, fear also comes in, especially where there's an interdependency. One of the things that I especially lost when I lost my parents was that I lost my friends. My parents were my friends. They were my counselors. They were also my greatest critic, because I'm quite headstrong. And it takes someone with a certain level of aptitude, someone that I respect, for them to knock sense into my head. And my parents could do it very easily. So I lost that. And so, you know, when you go through fear, you're thinking, oh my goodness, how am I going to cope without this resource? And a lot of the initial emotions for me when I lost my family, my parents, was feeling sorry for myself. I knew that they were believers. And I know what my spiritual family spiritual belief says about believers, that they are promoted to glory. But for that to reconcile with what I was going through in my own emotions, it just wasn't happening. And, you know, I was trying to carry on with work, because you have to. The bills still keep coming. So sometimes people can enter into a phase of numbness. You are just numb, like a paralysis. And you're just going through life one step in front of the other. Now, this is okay. In a way, it's functional. It's allowing you to get through stuff. But you've got to have a number of resources. It's useful to have friends who understand and empathize with you. Family members who are really on your side. And also, you know, co-workers or colleagues who really, really want the best for you. Sometimes at these vulnerable times, you find vouchers, people that you thought were really on your side, people that you thought were for you, need to encourage you to make decisions that are not going to serve you in the long term. So my suggestion and my recommendation is, when you are going through these stages of grief, especially when you're in the shock stage, defer any important decisions that have got permanent ramifications for your life. Things like, you sell the house if you've got an inheritance. Don't do that. If you and your husband or your partner are not getting along, it's not a time to say, I'm going to divorce. Because already emotionally, you are what? You are quite fragile. Your decisions are not necessarily coming from a place of wisdom, because you are traumatized. And then the other thing that comes in the shock and denial stage is blame. And this is where a lot of people find themselves maybe becoming isolated, because they may blame other members of the family. Especially in our African culture, some people, they start looking for answers such as Ndiana akaroya ningi utanga kufamba famba vachitsvaga nyaya dzekuti akaroya ningi. Some of it is superstition. Some people believe in these things, but it's less helpful when the bereavement has just taken place, because it's a time to put things in order. So that is the first stage, yeah, grief, shock and denial. Then there's the anger stage. And, you know, people can go through these loops and come round and swivel and there's no order. And they go through it in their own time. That's why I'm sharing with you. So anger involves frustration. It involves anxiety. It involves irritation. It involves embarrassment and shame. Especially nowadays where people may have issues about disclosing the reason for the passing on of the other. Which make people judgmental and stereotyped. It makes it very difficult for Muna Afirwa to embrace what's going on because the whole neighborhood is judging. Yet it's a time for people to be consoling another and to try and be moving on. Another big one is if the death is due to suicide or other, you know, other underhanded kind of ways. So it is extremely, extremely important that people understand, Kuti, when the emotion of anger comes in or sets in, the person that you love may cease to be that lovable and loving person, not because they are unreasonable. It's actually a cycle within grief. Then we've got shock and denial, we've got anger, then we move on to depression and detachment. And that will be a stage where you see the one akarashikirwa becoming overwhelmed. Even the smallest of tasks become mammothic in their nature. You know, somebody might not even be able to take care of their oral hygiene, might not even have a bath, might not even cook and eat well and look after themselves. Even in their workplace, they might not be functioning very well. You know, and it's not about what has underpinned the loss. Because some people lose a pet, their level of grief is the same as if a relative has passed on. Someone might lose a job and the level of grieving because of loss of income might be as huge as when they lost, you know, a parent or lost a grandparent. So it's not a time to judge, because when you go through grieving process, it's very personal and it's very real to the individual who's going through. So not being judgmental and being available to the best of your ability is important. If you're not able to be available and add value, it's best sometimes to just create a healthy distance and come every so often as and when you feel fit and able to do so. Lack of energy and helplessness is also the bit that sits in the realm of depression and detachment. And so people will be like, ah, they've got no libido, whatever. If somebody has been grieved, has been bereaved, they're not going to be functioning at their full capacity. So it's important to be understanding. And then after that, you have the next stage, which is dialogue and bargaining. And often this is from within, you know, even talking to those that have passed, trying to make sense of what's happening here, reaching out to others. People often have a desire to tell their story. It's a positive thing when someone is going through the dialogue and bargaining, but it can be very draining to the people whom they are seeking support from. So reaching out to others is really important. If you're not going to add value, do excuse yourself, because this is a very delicate time for the particular individual. Desire to tell one's story comes in different forms. Sometimes people just want to share pictures. Sometimes people want to share stories about the deceased. And sometimes it can bring other people into a sense of loss, which they are not ready to deal with once again. So, you know, it's important for you to be truthful and govern your presence in that individual's life so that you are a force for good rather than to be disruptive or disrespectful or being unsupportive. And there's also a struggle to find meaning for what has just happened. And that one is a big one, especially if the cause of death was unexpected, you know, especially with young people that are passing on. But why? Or the person was all right, you know. And this is particularly difficult, I recognize, for those people that are in diaspora in particular, who are not able to go back home, kundoita closure, or to arrive in time to, you know, to kind of have endings endings with their loved ones. So, you know, it's a time where sometimes family members want to rush the funeral when people are preparing to go to have closure. Some many same funerals don't rush to bury the deceased if they've got children or loved ones abroad. Give them time, kutivashike, because it will allow them to have a decent closure, which can allow them to get their lives back in order in a timely fashion. And so that's really, really important. And then the final stage is acceptance. That's where, you know, you are exploring the options, having a new plan in your life. So who am I now without parents? Where do I get my counsel? Where do I get, you know, the words of wisdom or critics? Who's going to be my new critic? And it took me ages to come to this stage, because when I lost my parents, they both went the very same week, the very same year, the very same month. So I didn't know about the stages of grief to apply it to my own life. And somehow I fudged along for about 10 or so years. And then it started to come together. And in my own mind, I could only deal with the loss of mom first. I couldn't even touch my relationship with my father because I was daddy's girl. And it was too difficult. I couldn't. And I didn't know that I couldn't, but I was kind of working through this the best way that I knew how and still trying to keep all of the responsibilities that I have going. You know, so it's really important if you are around somebody who's had a loss to know and recognize that they need relationships. They need meaningful relationships, relationships that add value. You know, and I had friends and family members. Some came and some went, depending on the level that they could deal with at the time, because I was completely inconsolable after I'd got into that deep stage of grief. You know, and I'm thankful for those people who didn't leave, or those who left temporarily and then came back. So when people are going through their grief, and maybe they'll be posting things on Facebook, if you can empathize with them and identify with them, it's always nice to add a word of encouragement, even to inbox. Because that would be a stage where maybe they are creating a sense of dialogue. They're trying to find a meaning. When we were much younger, we used to write things in diaries and keep it hidden under the mattress. Nowadays, you've got Facebook. So that's an invitation, I guess, when people put their things in the public space. So grief is a human emotional process. It's not something to run away from. It's not something to be embarrassed about. Because kufirwa kanauti, to lose something that you hold dear in your life, hurts, you know. And sometimes people, where there's sickness, it may be a preparation, especially once you are told that this illness is terminal. You start making the preparations. You know, we show our weakness, we show our distress, and sometimes you are helpless. And for those of you who get to see someone coming to end of life, in a way, you don't see it at the time, but it can be a blessing in disguise, because you will have the opportunity to do all those things that mean a lot to you that you will never get a chance to do again, you know. And where, you know, you've got responsible parents bringing up children. Children want to do something nice for their parents, to say thank you. You know, abandoning people because they are ill or they are terminally ill is not the way to go. I know that, you know, if you've got family members that are in countries where the healthcare is very poor, it can leave you bankrupt. But they were going bankrupt, send you to school, other things. So, you know, these are some of the things that grieve, because some people then start counting the cost, especially kuma extended families. Hospital, you know, dura, and so on. It's a personal choice. And I want to just talk to you about preparation. One of the things that makes life easy, especially once that time comes of the grief, is, are your things in order? Have you put together an advance directive? Do you have your arrangements? I want to have my funeral here. I want this done for me. I want this kind of ceremony. What kind of spiritual journey do you want? Do you want a Christian one? Do you want a traditional one? You have to spell some of those things out and write them down somewhere and let your loved ones know. Because sometimes you've got extended family members who now start jostling and pulling and tugging. And it makes those people that are the children or the widowed or the widower hurt even more than they need to, because the advance directives were not very clear. What are the burial wishes? And afterwards, nyaradzu dzenyu or memorial, how would you want it to be put up? And I'm saying these things because we face those sort of challenges when my parents passed away. Because people had different ideas about what they wanted. And we knew them very well and we knew what they would have liked. But then you have to concede and do things in a different way. And you feel like you're betraying those that have passed on. And another big one in our customary outlook is, kana munhu ashaya vachada guva ravo kuti rirohere. This is a traditional custom that means that there's a particular ceremony that is done that is very symbolic. Some people who are very Christian do not want guva kuti rirohe, and a lot of families, they fall out on these particular issues and they fall out irreparably, and meeting the costs, it's always an important to look at preparation around that and having will, because that makes things a lot easier for those that that remain. And another big one that makes people really confused is the issue of kugara naka. You know, if the husband is passed on, you know, at a particular time, there is a process that then spells out that one of the brothers may take on the woman who of the deceased, but you don't have to. There are ways to work around that, but it's something that is put forward. And the big one is kugova naka, which is, you know, the things, belongings that that the belongings of the deceased are given out, and who gets what, and you know, these are kind of clothes and you know, tools of their hobbies and that kind of thing. If you have certain jewelry or guitars or other things that you want certain members of your family to have, don't just leave it to fate. Write it down so that the person will be able to get the things that you want to bequeath to that particular individual. So the main things that I wanted to just highlight are that recognize your need for family and friends and prayer partners for support, discernment and sympathy, understanding, because the burden is great to carry, and it's not one that is easy to carry all by yourself. And this is the bit where if you have very little social capital, you are going to struggle, because when you hear that this thing that happened, some people are so idle, they don't have people to call on. So always try and, you know, be engaging, continue with relations with the, even the extended families at home, especially in the rural areas, because often when people pass on, they are taken to the rural areas. If you have not even been remembering those people that are in the rural areas, and then you expect them to help to further the procedures that need to be done, it's always in good standing that the relationships are maintained, and you know where you want to be, you know, where your remains ought to be. And on that particular issue, one of the things that has come to my attention is sometimes people are being buried in places that then, because of difficulty in relationship divorces, their children or those that remain find it difficult to then visit those places of their grave sites to pay their respects, because some people make it very difficult. I mean, why would anybody make it difficult for someone to arrive at a homestead where their parent is been buried, because they are putting those caveats to say, unless you do this and do this and do the other, gravesite. So these are some of the things as families we have to really look at, kuti apana mumwe munhu atiri kuomesera, especially when we've got this diaspora population of young people. You don't want everybody ending up burying their people abroad. So this is what I wanted to just highlight to you in terms of, I found it especially helpful because I find myself sometimes going back to a particular stage of grief, which I thought I was well and truly done with. And I'm just going to recap on those ones. So the stages of the grief cycle are as follows. There's no more functioning. You hear the news. You are struck by shock and denial. There's an avoidance. There's confusion. There's usually fear and numbness and blame. You know, and this can even be blaming yourself. And that makes it very difficult to move on. Then there's the next stage is anger. frustration, there's anxiety, irritation, embarrassment, and shame. Because I'm thinking of different people. And then the next stage, which is depression and detachment, which is when the individual is overwhelmed. And, you know, they lack energy and they're helpless. They're not functioning as well as they normally do or that you would expect them to. And that's a very sensitive time. So if you recognize that someone who's been bereaved is going through that, it's good to be supportive. And then there's the dialogue and bargaining. When that individual is reaching out, they have a desire to tell their story, or they are struggling to find the meaning of what has happened. You know, someone could ask you 10 times in a month and want to talk to you about the same things. If they've just been over this, allow them to vent, because the fact that they are talking to you about it means that they've identified something about you. That means that you are accessible. It's actually a gift that you can give somebody else, which is your time. And then acceptance, exploring options, a new plan in place. And this people come to this particular stage of returning to meaningful life on their own, but you start seeing them getting back on the on their treadmill, so to speak, and walking the walk, and you know, reorganizing themselves or finding a new job, or you know, talking in more healthy dialogue about their loss. And in that place, they regain their security, they feel empowered, and their self-esteem is boosted again, and they have found meaning, and they have found a definition of who they are without their loved ones. Often, if it's been husband and wife and one of them goes, the other is now finding themselves, who they are without that person. So it's a time to identify themselves. And you know, even when we talk about grief, we should not forget that Zimbabweans are always grieving the loss of the good Zimbabwe that we remember. So grief is not just about the loss of a person. It can be loss of a sense of security that you had, a sense of job security that you had. If you ukanyura financially, you can go through that very same grief cycle. Or even if you lose your health, especially whether these cancers or diabetes, your lifestyle changes. So you can go through those stages of grief, but they apply to that particular situation that you are grieving. So I think that's everything that I wanted to say on this particular thread. I'm just going to see if anybody's written any comment that I need to respond to. I can see you guys are there. Thank you so much. Anzina Fat Hazel. It will indeed, and no one can ever be prepared. Some spend more time in denial or can either become isolated and withdrawn from everything and everyone. Thanks, Tete Rasta. Yeah, no, that's very true. For me, it took me about 10 years before I got to a stage of really feeling like I wanted to re-engage meaningfully, because before then I just was existing, going through stage by stage, and you know, even now when I have other losses with relatives that go by, I'm now recognizing that grief cycle and knowing where I am in it. And when those anniversaries come, I have to kind of balance it out, because when anniversaries come, it creates a very powerful emotional flashback to the other most significant losses that you've had. And when now every day you're seeing happy shares of Facebook and other people losing their loved ones close to them, you enter their grief cycle with them as well. So it's something just to be mindful of, and be sensitive to, and to help one another as people endure through this. But the most important thing is to know that grief is a normal pattern of life, and it's not something that anybody can run away from. What we must remember is that we rejoice with those that are rejoicing, and we weep with those that are weeping. And every situation does pass. It's just a matter of time, and everybody's time is very, very different. But Chikuru is to be caring and loving towards one another, and to be available in a meaningful way that does not take anything away from you. Anzi Nadedi, you're doing an excellent job, Tete Rasta. Keep it up. Aiwa maitabasa baba dinoyedza. And Silvano says ndikoko. I just thought I would share that. I'm now, in terms of my own grief of my parents, I'm now in a much better place, in a much better time. It has not always been easy. I celebrate their lives because vakaita pau, vakapedza, it's now up to me. So I want to make sure that I invest all the best memories I can into my son, into my family, because there'll be one day where they will have nothing but those memories. So I urge you and I encourage you to build your social capital in your family and in your friends and in your community, because nguva yedu ishoma, nguva yedu idiki, and you don't know when your name will be called. But I just thought I'll share with you the grief cycle, because it helps to make sense of certain things that seem so complex, but everybody goes through it. And if you are grieving yourself right now, because that is the way that has been designed, and God is God, you do what He does. I'll end with Stan's positive. And